Hi, my name is Omar Nadeem from the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston, Massachusetts. I want to thank the organizing committee for inviting me to give this presentation. And today we'll be talking about the role of bispecific monoclonal antibodies in CAR T-cell therapy in multiple myeloma. These are my disclosures. So as we're all very much aware, myeloma therapy has evolved significantly over the past several decades, but notably over the last 5 or so years, with discovery of numerous novel agents, including monoclonal antibodies, next-generation proteasome inhibitors and immunomodulatory drugs, and more recently, the approval of 2 BCMA-directed therapies in belantamab mafodotin and ide-cel CAR T-cell therapy. So B-cell maturation antigen, or BCMA, is a relatively new target in multiple myeloma. It is expressed nearly universally on all myeloma cells and some mature B-cells, and it's involved in proliferation and survival of these mature B-cells and plasma cells. It is cleaved from the cell surface via an enzyme called gamma secretase, and this is another area of therapeutic interest now, particularly as a way of optimizing the benefit from BCMA-directed therapies. There have been several different methods of targeting BCMA in myeloma. So this has included CAR T-cell therapy, antibody drug conjugates, and bispecific antibodies or bispecific T-cell engagers, and all of them have been in simultaneous development in myeloma. And if you look at some examples of the current agents targeting BCMA, the antibody drug conjugate space has belantamab mafodotin, which was the first FDA-approved anti-BCMA therapy in myeloma. In terms of CAR T cells, the first approval came in the form of ide-cel, which was approved in March of 2021. And it is highly anticipated that the next product will be cilta-cel, which is a Janssen product. Currently anticipated approval is early next year, adding to the available CAR T cell therapies in the clinic for myeloma. In terms of bispecific antibodies, currently there are no approved agents, but several are under investigation, as you can see listed here, via many different companies, and they're all in dose finding or phase 2 studies at the moment. There's also combination studies ongoing with bispecific antibodies, and some of these have been recently reported. Starting off with belantamab mafodotin, so this was the antibody drug conjugate that was approved based on the DREAM-2 study, revealing an overall response rate of 32% in a highly refractory myeloma population, translating into a median duration of response of 11 months. The Achilles heel of belantamab mafodotin so far has been the incidence of keratopathy, and this is something that has been challenging to mitigate in the clinic and utilizes and requires frequent visits with ophthalmology for optimal management. However, there's been significant excitement with the development of CAR T cells in myeloma. And just for review, a CAR chimeric antigen receptor is a transmembrane receptor that contains an extracellular domain that targets the tumor cell. So BCMA in myeloma contains a transmembrane domain and an intracellular domain, which is CD3 zeta, with a co-stimulatory domain of either CD28 or 4-1BB, the latter being the one currently utilized in myeloma. As you can see below, the CAR T cell process involves leukapheresis, followed by manufacturing, which can take approximately 1 month, during which patients frequently will require bridging therapy. And then this is followed by CAR T cell infusion after 3 days of lymphodepletion with fludarabine and cyclophosphamide. And the patient then receives their CAR T cells and then they're monitored for toxicities. The first approved BCMA targeting CAR T-cell is ide-cel. This is an autologous CAR T-cell, again, anti-BCMA with a 4-1BB co-stimulatory domain. And the difference between this and cilta-cel, which is off to the right, is that they both have BCMA targeting capabilities, but cilta-cel has 2 BCMA binding domains. So this leads to higher avidity and a stronger bond with the myeloma cell, perhaps leading to some of the increased activity that we're seeing in this particular product, which I'll go over shortly. First, starting with ide-cel. So the KARMA trials are the trials that led to the approval of ide-cel. So this was the phase 2 KARMA update, revealing an overall response rate of 73% in a highly refractory myeloma population that on average had 6 prior lines of therapy, and a complete response rate of 33%, which translated into a median PFS of 8.8 months. However, if you look at it by target dose, you can see that there's clearly a dose-dependent improvement in PFS. So patients that were treated at the 450 million dose had a median PFS of approximately 12 months compared to those with the lower dose where the PFS was a lot lower. And the PFS by response is depicted to the right, and you can clearly see that patients that had a CR, a stringent CR, did the best with a median PFS of 20 months in that population, and the PFS being substantially lower in patients that just had a partial response of 5.4 months. In terms of cilta-cel, the CARTITUDE-1 trial has been recently updated, revealing an overall response rate of 97.9% and a stringent CR rate with longer follow-up of 82.5%, which is quite impressive and seems on paper at least to be greater than what we've seen so far in the KARMA trials with ide-cel. In patients that were MRD evaluable, almost all were MRD negative at 91.8 months. And you can see here the responses were relatively quick with the median time to first response for all patients of only 1 month. The median duration of response so far is 21.8 months, and the responses deepened over time, as mentioned, with a stringent CR rate of 83% at the median follow-up of 2 years. And in terms of PFS, the two-year PFS seems quite favorable at 60.5 months, with a median PFS that's currently not reached. And if you look at patients that had a stringent CR, the numbers appear to be even better with a two-year PFS of 71%. So, you know, clearly in the absence of doing cross-trial comparisons, which we should definitely be cautious about, you can certainly see that the responses seem to be greater. And so far, the PFS seems to be longer in the patients that are treated with cilta-cel thus far compared to the ide-cel studies as reported. So if you look at that in a little bit more detail, there are some differences to note that I've highlighted with the arrows. So the first major difference is that the median onset of CRS with cilta-cel appears to be later. So it's at 7 days as opposed to 1 day with ide-cel. And this may have some implications as we use these products in the clinic in terms of outpatient versus inpatient administration. In terms of neurological toxicity, there was initial reports of delayed neurological toxicity seen in the CARTITUDE-1 study. With the subsequent updates, there have not been further reports of delayed neurotoxicity. And some of this has been some mitigation techniques that have been suggested with optimizing bridging therapy to reduce the tumor burden in some patients going through CAR T cells with cilta-cel. So this is an area that was initially of concern, but now I think with longer follow-up, you know, we're thankfully not seeing more of this so far in the updates of these studies. In terms of responses, as we just discussed, you know, the cilta-cel response rate seems to be higher and the CR rate seems to be substantially greater compared to ide-cel. And the PFS, as mentioned, was 8.8 months with ide-cel, and it's at 24 months at 60.5% with cilta-cel. And if you look across the board, these are just two examples of the products that are, you know, either available or will be shortly available in the clinic. You can see there's several other CAR T products currently under investigation. Across the board, we're seeing very, very impressive response rates and deep responses in patients treated with these therapies. And you know, with longer follow-up and more trials that are currently ongoing, we know we'll hopefully see even greater and enhanced activity of these particular therapies in the myeloma patient population going forward. I wanted to highlight a couple of new targets that are currently under investigation. So the first is GPRC5D, and this stands for G protein coupled receptor class 5 group 5 member D receptor. So this was the first phase 1 first in class trial of MCAR-109, which targets GPRC5D via a CAR T mechanism. So GPRC5D, again, is a novel target discovered in myeloma and is highly expressed in myeloma cells with limited normal tissue expression, with the exception of skin and hair follicles. And you can see here so far, patients treated on that study, 16 patients, you know, the overall response rate is about approximately 70%, which is quite favorable, with an MRD negativity rate of 50%. And if you look at the bottom, you can see that patients that have had prior BCMA-directed therapy had a response rate of 80%, which is quite impressive. And patients that had prior CAR T-cell therapy, which were also included in the study, their overall response rate was 75%. So suggesting that a novel agent, different target than BCMA, you know, certainly is welcomed and something that we can think about when we talk about sequencing some of these therapies in the future. Now shifting gears to bispecific antibodies, this is again a different way of essentially directing the T cells to the myeloma cell. So you have one end that targets CD3 and the other targets a tumor cell, in this case BCMA, leading to cell death and cellular lysis. So I wanted to highlight some of these studies that have been recently reported. So this was the phase 1 trial of teclistamab, which is a bispecific antibody targeting BCMA. And you can see here at the recommended phase 2 dose of 1500 micrograms per kilogram subcutaneous weekly, the overall response rate was 65%, with 41% of patients having a complete response. And if you look at other dosing cohorts that are currently under investigation with this particular agent, you can see, you know, the drug is quite active with an overall response rate of 70%. The CRS rate seems to be a bit lower at 56.7%, and the neurological rates in terms of grade 1 to 3 neurological toxicity was quite low at 4.5%. Now, switching gears a bit to a different target that has recently been reported, and this is an Fc receptor homolog 5 or FcRH5 receptor that is expressed exclusively in the B cell lineage with almost universal expression in myeloma cells. So this is a BCMA, this is a bispecific antibody targeting this particular receptor. And this is a report of this phase 1 study that was recently presented at ASH. So as you can see here, there's several different doses still currently being studied. And at the 20 milligram target dose and above, which included 143 patient, you can see that the overall response rate seems quite favorable. So if you look at the across the board at the higher dose levels, you can see that the overall response rate was almost 60%, 56.7% in that population with the VGPR greater rate of 33%. Again, this is it seems to be pretty active in a refractory patient population, with majority of the responses occurring quite early at 1 month. If you look at duration of response so far, this is at approximately 11.5 months, which again seems quite favorable compared to the other reports with the agents that we've already discussed. And this adds to a different mechanism or target in the myeloma treatment landscape. On a similar theme as depicted earlier with the CAR T product targeting GPRC5D, this is now a bispecific antibody targeting GPRC5D with talquetamab. And the Monumental 1 trial was updated at ASH this year using this bispecific antibody in a relapsed refractory myeloma population, revealing again an impressive overall response rate of 70% with a VGPR rate of greater of over 50% in this particular population. And there's several different doses currently being studied at 405 micrograms per kilogram weekly subcutaneously, or 800 micrograms per kilogram twice monthly subcutaneously. And you can see that the responses are quite comparable between the two. And again, highly active with a different target and a new target in this clinical trial. So just to look across the board, you know, I didn't want to highlight every single update recently of all these agents, but I think you can see a lot of similarity. So we have several BCMA targeting bispecific antibodies in development. You know, we discussed teclistamab, but there are several others as depicted in this table, and they're all demonstrating an overall response rate that seems to be anywhere between 60 and 80% across the board. And I would say the CRS rate seems to be lower if you look at some of these agents compared to what we're used to seeing with CAR T cell therapy, and similarly, a very low incidence of neurological toxicity. I think where the attractiveness lies here is just the off-the-shelf ability of these agents, and particularly the dosing structure, which is subcutaneous, and some of them at a relatively manageable interval, which a lot of myeloma patients are already used to. And on the bottom there are the two novel targets using bispecific antibodies that we just discussed, including talquetamab and cevostamab, both of them showing significant activity in this relapse population, again, with a dosing structure that is quite convenient for patients. So I wanted to end by just talking about a few points in terms of open questions of where BCMA targeted therapy will be in 2022. So the first question is, which is the most optimal method to deliver anti-BCMA therapy? I would argue that CAR T cells still have the highest response rates, but the challenges with CAR T cell therapy currently include availability. So despite approval of ide-cel, we've had very limited ability to treat a lot of these patients that clearly could benefit from that particular therapy. Now, I'm hoping this would be better with the approval of cilta-cel, but I still think with the process that's required in treating somebody with CAR T cell, that's always going to be a rate limiting step in terms of its use. There's also the manufacturing delay with these autologous CAR T cells. So there is, you know, some concerns about bridging therapy and keeping patients stable for them to be able to receive this therapy because they're not off the shelf. And similarly, I think toxicity eligibility concerns, you do see higher rates of CRS. It does require hospitalization. And you know, there may be a subset of elderly myeloma patients that perhaps will not be fit enough to receive CAR T cells. In terms of belantamab mafodotin, it's readily available, but I think the keratopathy has been difficult to manage, as we had discussed, and the coordination of care with ophthalmology can be a challenge. But this is now currently being studied in different doses and combinations, and hopefully that'll help with its use and ease of use, really, in clinic for myeloma patients. And I think bispecific antibodies may strike that ideal balance, as they're off the shelf without patient dosing and then generally lower toxicity. And as discussed, combination therapies and new targets are currently under study with bispecifics. So I think it's great to have all these options, which will be the most optimal method. I think they all have their pros and cons, and really have to have a discussion with the patient about those particular risks and benefits. So the next open question that I think is pertinent is, can you administer one BCMA-directed therapy after another? So far, we've had very limited data to guide effectiveness, as some of the trials had excluded prior BCMA therapies or CAR T cells. But with now an approved product and more to come, I think we'll generate more real-world evidence in terms of sequencing some of these particular therapies. I did want to highlight one study that was from the Sinai group that was presented at ASH this year. This actually looked at salvage therapy after failure of first bispecific antibody. So they included 116 patients that were treated on trials with prior bispecific antibodies, and then 60 patients received salvage therapy. And the breakdown you can see listed there. So about a third received a form of T-cell redirection, which included bispecifics and CAR T-cells, and others that had received just kind of more conventional approved triplet-type regimens, amongst other therapies for myeloma. And what I thought was interesting with this is that, you know, we saw that the therapy was quite effective in terms of sequencing. So patients that did receive T-cell redirecting therapy afterwards had an overall response rate of 81% versus 55% in the population that didn't. So clearly suggesting activity of that particular sequence. And then if you look at PFS in patients that had T-cell redirecting therapy versus not, you can see the median PFS was substantially greater in patients that did versus not. So despite being a single sort of center, smaller subset of patients, I think this is encouraging that the activity still persists. And in anecdotal experience, I think we're certainly seeing that in patients that have had T-cell therapy after belantamab mafodotin, for example, or a bispecific antibody trial. So the next question I think that comes up a lot is, so which line of therapy will we be administering BCMA-directed therapy in the future? So right now, the current approval is in patients that have had four prior lines of therapy, but I think it's important to acknowledge that increasing number of patients are going to be triple class refractory earlier due to increased use of quadruplets in induction and maintenance. So I think this is going to increase the refractoriness of patients in earlier lines of therapy, and currently studies are ongoing in both 1 to 3 prior lines and also in newly diagnosed myeloma, both in a high risk and standard risk subgroups. And then head-to-head studies with CAR T cells versus autologous transplant are planned. And this is something that's going to help answer that question about, can you actually bring it that far up the chain in terms of myeloma therapeutics? So to summarize, I think we've covered a lot of different advantages and disadvantages of all these three different methods of administering BCMA-directed therapies between antibody-drug conjugates, CAR T-cells, and bispecific antibodies. Some of those have been highlighted here on this table, but bottom line is they all have their pros and cons, and I think it's great to have all these options available in the future for patients. So to conclude, anti-BCMA therapy with CAR T-cells, bispecifics, and antibody-drug conjugates are a great option for patients with triple-class refractory myeloma. As mentioned, limitations exist with each approach. With belantamab mafodotin, we have the keratopathy issue. With CAR T-cells, we have availability and manufacturing as an issue. And with bispecific antibodies, they're not yet approved. But you know, I think this is something that as I mentioned, hopefully will strike the optimal balance in terms of availability and also ease of use. And I think we need to still understand better the mechanism of resistance, particularly with CAR T-cells, in terms of why patients progress after CAR T-cell therapy. There's new targets currently under study that include GPRC5D and the FCRH5 studies that I highlighted, along with allogeneic CAR T cells, actually, that are some of them have been reported that look quite promising, which have the off-the-shelf capabilities. Combination therapy trials are ongoing, which I think will be really exciting to see if we can further optimize the benefit that is seen with these therapies. And I think understanding optimal sequencing will be really important going forward, particularly as we will have more and more of these BCMA-directed agents and other targets available in the clinic. With that, I want to say thank you and have a great day.